January 25th, you'll be, had you lived, 230 years old. It's a long time ago.
It goes by quickly when you're not paying attention to the clock.
I don't want to ask you what you've been doing for 230 years. But listen, you're one of the most controversial figures in history, and a lot of people maybe don't know this. You've got a reputation as a drinker. Let's start with that. Tell me about your reputation. How did you get a reputation as a drinker?
How does anyone get a reputation? I think a man called Charles Kirkpatrick Sharp put it better, I think, than anybody else ever has. When writers die, he said, what lies people who might have seen them and known them can tell about them. Now, for 200 years, I've been sort of sitting back in the wings of life, you might say, listening to what people have to say about me, about who I was and what I was and why I was it, and what I should have been. And I've been alternately appalled and delighted. I have been flattered and humiliated. I have been damn well outraged by what people have said about me. I was me. I was an ordinary man. I was what the French call l'homme moyen sensuel, the ordinary, unremarkable man, with one minor exception. I was extremely remarkable.
And not a bit of ego there, either.
Well, of course there is a bit of ego there. The thing is that I committed a sin called the sin of rhyme. I didn't do anything that nobody else did. Nothing that I did was new. Nothing that I did was outrageous within the society I lived in. But I wrote it down. I wrote about it. If I met a lassie, and she excited me, and she charmed me, and she captured me, and I was able and lucky enough to excite and charm and capture her, then I wrote a song about it, because I wanted to celebrate it.
You excited and charmed and captured a few, though.
Well, yes, in a manner of speaking.
I'm not asking for numbers, but you also got a reputation as a bit of a womanizer.
I suppose I have, yes, yes. But that's how I got it. I happened to write about the women I loved. I mean, I don't think there's a man alive who is normal who can lay claim to the title man who hasn't met at least 4, 5, 6 girls on the way through life.
He just didn't write it down.
He didn't write beautiful songs about them. I did. And when I say beautiful songs, again, I suppose you could accuse me of overweening pride. But the tunes, the songs, the melodies were memorable, and they were not mine. I didn't write the songs.
Where did you get
this? I didn't write the melodies.
You wrote the words.
I wrote the words.
About the bonny wee lassies.
Yes.
Where did the...
Some bonny big lassies, too.
Were there? Maybe we can talk about that in a minute or two, yeah. But where did the music come from, then?
A couple of men that I met in the course of my life had become interested in writing down and accumulating collections of ancient Scottish melodies. And I of course, had acquired some amount of notoriety. I had a name during my life, and people would talk to me because they knew I was a writer. And so these gentlemen approached me and asked me if I would consider keeping an eye out in my travels for melodies, for tunes, and collecting them for them, and then they paid me for collecting the tunes. And in the last 15 years of my life, and latterly, as I got closer to the end of my life, more and more time went into collecting these old tunes. And it was these tunes to which I wrote my lyrics. It was the tunes that excited me, the melodies
and yet,
created my...
You're not a musician.
No,
you never
not.
Were.
No, and I've got a tin ear when it comes to singing, or so I'm told. But...
So how did you... You obviously didn't write the music down. Where did it come from? How did you collect it?
I would listen to you, for example, with a tune that I had heard that you have, you sing a song. I would then I had an old fiddle, and I would take that fiddle and I would pick out the melody, and I got pretty good at it eventually, but I could pick out the melody on one string of that fiddle. I could pick it out well enough to embed it in my own memory.
Memorize it and take it home.
Yes. Then I would take it home, and then I would write lyrics to it.
Amazing. You've written them. Okay. Let's go through the, and then I wrote. All right. Yeah. You heard that syndrome that happens to modern-day writers, and then I wrote this.
Oh, yes, and then I wrote this.
And we know some pretty famous songs that you've written, Robert
Burns.
Yeah,
one of them, one song that amuses me very greatly, is a wee silly wee thing that I picked up in a bar in Inverness, I think, someplace up north. And it was a catchy wee tune, and I took it away, and I wasn't particularly happy with the way the words ran together, so I rewrote it, and I wrote a couple of verses to it, but I never considered it worth anything. And it was a song in celebration of friendship. All of a sudden, that wee song that I thought nothing of has become probably the most famous song in the entire western half of the world.
Can you give me a few bars?
Yes. It goes, should old acquaintance be forgot and never brought to mind? Should old acquaintance be forgot and auld lang syne? For auld lang syne, my dears, for auld lang syne, we'll take a cup o' kindness yet for auld lang syne. That word syne is the same word as the English word since, and it starts with a s, an s. Americans love to put a z in the front of that, a z,
auld
as they call
syne.
It, auld lang syne.
That's one of the things you cringe over now.
Oh, I burrow in my grave like a peary. I just spin.
You must feel very good, though, this little song that you put together back then.
It's
200 years ago.
Very flattering, yes. Yes.
It has become a standard around the world.
Yeah.
What else? And then I wrote. What else did you put your name to that we might know?
Oh, there is so much that I put my name to without even meaning to that people use all the time. Man's inhumanity to man. Everybody has heard of man's inhumanity to man. I have the dubious distinction of being the first person to write that down. Man's inhumanity to man makes countless thousands mourn.
How did you, by the way, I don't want to interrupt you here. One of my favorite, and probably my favorite, many people's favorite, that you've ever written was To a Moose.
Yes.
And yet, it's the topic is about as low as you can go. Where did you come upon the idea?
Oh, the idea was with me all my life. What I did was turn out a little mouse that had done nothing to offend me, and it was just one of those cataclysmic events of nature where the mouse was living in its nest looking forward to a quiet winter, and suddenly my plowshare just came bursting right through the walls of its house. That made me think how futile in many ways the life of man is, because no matter what you try to do and no matter how you try to protect yourself, you are totally at the mercy of what often seems to be an uncaring force that we call nature. And again, of all the things I've written, that's probably the one that gets most mangled most often, because the opening line of the poem is, we sleek it cower and timorous beastie. That, people who speak English find that amusing, because I didn't write it in English, that's written in Scots. Sleek it means sleek, smooth and soft. Cowering is cowering. Timorous is frightened.
Mm-hmm.
So here we have this little timid, quaking beast.
Oh, what a panic's in thy breastie.
Panic's in thy breastie. You needn't start away so hasty with bicker and brattle. I would be loath to run and chase you with murder and battle. I'm truly sorry that man's dominion has broken nature's social union and justifies that ill opinion that makes thee startle at me, thy poor earth-born companion and fellow mortal. I have no doubt sometimes you may steal the one thief. What then, poor beastie? The man live, you've got to live. A daemon icker and a thrave, a tiny wee bit in an emergency. A daemon icker and a thrave's a small request. I'll get a blessing with a lave and never miss it. And thy wee bit housey too, in ruin. Its silly walls the winds are strewing, and there's nothing now to build a new one of foliage green, and bleak December's winds ensuing, baith snell and keen. You saw the field laid bare and waste, and dreary winter coming fast, and cozy here beneath the blast you thought to dwell, till crash the cruel colder passed out through thy cell. That wee bit heap of leaves and stubble has cost you many a weary nibble, and now you're turned out, for all your trouble, without house or hold, to thole the winter's sleety dribble and cranruch cold. But Moosey, you're not alone in proving foresight may be vain. The best laid plans of mice and men gang aft a glee, and leave us naught but grief and pain for promised joy. Still, thou art blessed compared with me. The present only touches thee. But och, I backwards cast my ee on prospects drear, and forward, though I canna see, I guess and fear.
I loved that poem for years now. I love it even more.
It's a beautiful,
marvelous, marvelous. Probably, probably your best known, aside from Auld Lang Syne, obviously.
Yes, I think so.
Nobody knows all the words, but we all have heard the best laid plans of mice and men.
Even John Steinbeck.
Even John.
That one.
Another compliment for you.
Yes.
You never did answer me about your drinking. We started this off with your drinking. You sort of sidestepped that. Tell me about that.
Well, looking back on it 200 years, I can talk about it now. I died at the age of 37. I died of a combination of illnesses that had been building up on me throughout my life. When I was a boy working on my father's farms, I was behind the plow in all kinds of weather, and I developed rheumatic fever, and it affected my heart very badly. And then later on in life, I developed endocarditis, which is an inflammation of the lining of the heart. Now, one of the side effects of endocarditis is that strong drink plays hell with you if you suffer from that. So I was never able to really drink any large amounts of hard liquor. But by the same token, in the days in which I lived, you have to consider a man in the society he lived in. It was nothing for the gentry to sit down at dinner and for each man to drink two bottles of claret with dinner. The drinking, the wine drinking, was gargantuan. And a man then, pretty well as now, was gauged on his capacity to drink. Now, see, I was Poet Burns. My human frailty, physical frailty, wouldn't allow me to drink as much as I did. My other human frailty, my personality, would not allow me to admit that I was incapable of drinking. And so in letters to friends, many letters to many friends, I alluded to these gargantuan drinking bouts that I was involved in with all my cronies. But in fact, I was a moderate drinker. One night, I came out of a meeting and had a very, very bad attack and passed out on the steps of a house wearing my uniform. I was in a constable's meeting. And I couldn't get up. I was fully conscious, but I was in so much pain that I couldn't move. And I heard a lady pass by me. She stepped over me, and I heard her say, "Oh, aye, Poet Burns, drunk again." I wasn't drunk. I was sick. But I couldn't even ask her to help me.
So from the now, it can be told. You know, I look at you, and I believe you.
Good. It's true.
230 years after the fact. You died at 37.
Mm-hmm. 37, yes.
What was that like?
Pretty much the same as dying at any other age, I would think. It was a chastening experience, particularly prior to the event. I was 37 years old, in rapidly failing health. I had an idiot of an incompetent doctor who prescribed that for the good of my health, I should immerse myself daily in the sea. And the sea in Scotland in June is icy cold. Well, I had rheumatic fever for a start. So my series of dips in the sea at noon finished me off. I returned back home, took to my bed, and died within the month.
You know,
and I was terrified. I died in fear. I was afraid of what was going to happen to my family because Jean had the kids to look after. We had no money coming in. And I was terrified that they would be dispossessed, that they would be thrown out on the streets. Had I known, I could have died a lot more easily.
You know, they've kept your cottage. Was that where you died, or did you die elsewhere?
I was born in that cottage. Which
That's
is
where
why
you
they,
were
yes,
born.
They've turned it into some kind of shrine. My father built it. Built it just shortly before I was born. And it had been completed for less than a month when we moved in, and my mother was pregnant. And one night there was a storm came up, and my mother delivered me in the middle of that storm, and in the middle of the same storm, the gable wall at the end of the house blew right in. My father wasn't a builder, he was a gardener.
Well, they rebuilt it, and it looks marvelous, and they keep it there, and it looks terrific. You'd be proud of it now.
I have seen it, yes. It's a tribute to something, to the Scotsman's love of racial heritage or to the longevity of his sentiment. I don't know.
One final question. What do you think of haggis? Do you like haggis?
Oh, I love haggis. Yes, and if you had lived when I lived, you would love it too. You know that I was brought up, I think I must have been 14 before I tasted my first haggis. Because in Scotland, not my family and not just us, the ordinary people in Scotland in those days never ate meat. There was no meat. We lived on potatoes, we lived on oatmeal, we lived on kale. Very few potatoes. Mostly kale, Scotch cabbage, mostly oatmeal. There's a report that was submitted at the time of my birth to the Board of Agriculture talking about my home county of Ayr. And if I can remember part of it, let me think here. It said, at that time, there was hardly a practicable road in the country. The few ditches that existed were ill-preserved and in a terrible state of disrepair. The houses were mere hovels, being moted about with clay, having an open hearth or a fire pit in the middle, and a dunghill at the door. The people were starving and wretched, and the cattle lived in the house with the families. There were no green grass, no sown crops, no vegetables, except for a scanty. No hay. That's correct. No hay. And nothing except for a few Scotch kale, which together with milk and oatmeal made up the diet of the people. The ground was scourged with a succession of oats after oats after oats until as long as they would pay for the rent and afford a small surplus for the family. And after that, the ground was left to lie in a state of absolute ruin until rest again persuaded it to reproduce a scanty crop. Now those are the words, as well as I can remember them, of an official report. People today have absolutely no conception of the poverty in which we lived. We did not have meat. So eventually, occasionally, someone would kill a pig or a sheep or a beef steer. The gentry ate the meat. The peasantry were given the offal, the liver, the lights, the heart, the stomach. It was meat. So we would take it. It wasn't very pleasant meat. But we would take it. We would cut it up very, very small. We would mix it with spices and with oatmeal. And we would use it combined with oatmeal to make a very nourishing and substantial sausage. And that's what the haggis is. It's a sausage.
In the stomach.
Yes. And we wrapped it in the sheep's stomach, which everyone turns their nose up nowadays, because everybody very conveniently forgets that before the invention of plastic, in which your sausages are wrapped today, everything was wrapped in the intestines of animals. That's what a sausage was. So the arrival of a haggis on a table in a Scottish household was an occasion of great celebration. It was meat. It was solid, tasty, substantial food. It was something to be very grateful for. Hence my address to the haggis. And when I said to that haggis, "Fare for your honest, sonsy face," that means, "God bless your open, honest, magnificent countenance, great chieftain of the pudding race, because you take your place above them all. Any kind of food you want to mention, there's nothing to equal the haggis. Well are ye worthy of a grace as long as my arm. The groaning trencher, there you fill your hurdies, your buttocks, like a distant hill. The pin that you're tied together, your pin would help to mend a mill in time of need, while through your pores the dews distill like amber beads."
I may yet learn to like haggis. What do you prefer to be called? Robert, Robbie, Rob, Bob, Bobby?
My friends call me Robin.
Robin?
Yes.
Nobody ever calls you Robin Burns today?
No. Robin was how I thought of myself. That autobiographical song I wrote about myself, "There Was a Lad Was Born in Kyle." But what in a day, what in a style, I doot it's hardly worth my while to be so nice with Robin. For Robin was a roving lad, ranting, roving, ranting, roving. Robin was a roving lad, ranting, roving, Robin. That's how I thought of myself. My buddies called me Rab. Rab. And Rab Burns is what I've been known as mostly. Ogden Nash, the American humorist, wrote a poem about me. And in it he talked about all the names I was told, and there's one beautiful couplet in that, and he said, "I have an inexpensive hobby. It's simply not to call him Bobby." Call me anything you want, but don't call me Bobby Burns.
I'll call you Mr. Burns, how's that?